Hey there. Let's pretend I'm a fossil you've found. Pretty cool, eh? I know you're going to want to show me to all your friends, but I also want to let you know how much you can learn from me. First off, you've probably already figured out what kind of organism I was before I died and became a fossil, right? Are you thinking fish? And you know also that I swam in the water. Because I'm a really complete fossil, you could probably tell exactly what kind of fish I was if you know a lot about that sort of thing. For example, you'd look at the shape of my tail or the bones in my jaw to figure this out. Because this video is about fossils, not fish identification, I won't explain those details. But suffice it to say that if you were a paleontologist, comparative anatomist, ichthyologist, or other specialist, you'd know these things. Here's another fossil for you to examine. Or, well, a clip art image that we're pretending is a fossil. Is this a fish too? Of course not. It's a human, or maybe an ancestor of humans called a hominin. Either way, you have a pretty good idea of what it is. Okay, but what happens if you only have a partial fossil? An ichthyologist or paleontologist would still know a lot from this because there are still important features preserved. It just takes a little more work to figure out what might be missing. This is a common problem with fossil remains of hominins. But paleontologists and anthropologists, oh yeah. Paleontologists and anthropologists might look at a single bump on a single bone and know a lot about the hominin. For example, they would hypothesize a fossil was of an animal that walked on two legs, like a hominin, just because it has a large bump on its pelvis where large thigh muscles attach. Only animals that walk upright on two legs have these long thigh muscles and therefore need big bumps to anchor those muscles in place. Sometimes a paleontologist lucks out, and instead of having only a partial fossil, or a single pretty complete one, she has multiple fossils that give her additional important information. For example, if you had found a whole bunch of fossils that looked like me, all together facing the same direction, you might hypothesize my species was a social fish that swam in schools. Likewise, if you find certain kinds of tools together with a hominin fossil, you'd hypothesize the hominin made and used those tools. This might lead you to hypothesize further about what the hominin did with those tools, like hunting. Ew, that actually looks like a fishing spear. Lots of other information can be obtained from fossils by performing various tests on them. You've probably heard of scientists extracting DNA from fossils. By sequencing DNA from a 40,000-year-old Neanderthal fossil, we learned that about 2% of DNA in a modern European person is the same as DNA in Neanderthals. Just as amazing is the possibility of determining whether a fossil is from a species that was endothermic or ectothermic. Now, with me, you'd probably just hypothesize I was ectothermic because I was a fish. But if you wanted to test it, you could do that by measuring the ratio of two different isotopes of oxygen in my bones. The ratio of oxygen 18 to oxygen 16 in the bone depends on the temperature when the bones were made. Bones are remodeled or partially broken down and rebuilt throughout the life of an organism. So when I refer to the oxygen isotope ratio from when bones were made, that could be when the animal was first developing or at any time later in its life. So bones made in an ectotherm when it was cold out would have a different oxygen isotope ratio than bones produced or remodeled by the same animal when it was warmer. Some of its bones would have had different ratios than others at the time it died and fossilized, just because they were remodeled more recently and under different temperatures. But an endotherm maintains the same internal body temperature, and so its bones all have pretty much the same oxygen isotope ratio. I hope you've learned a lot from me today, that you can identify a fossil, even if it's only a partial specimen, maybe learn something about its behavior or other aspects of its biology if it's found together with other fossils or artifacts, and possibly even test its DNA or other molecular and chemical properties to learn about the genetics and physiology of the once-living organism.